You're listening to Big Table, a podcast about books and conversation presented by Hat and Beard Press, Dub Lab, and Gold Diggers in Los Angeles. I'm your host, JC Gabel. For each episode, we speak to one author about a singular book in a long-form interview. Each interview is then followed by a brief reading, sometimes from the same book being discussed, sometimes by a like-minded title and a different author. But every episode does retain a loose theme throughout and is inspired by the work of radio host and oral historian Studs Terkel. Thanks for listening. For over 50 years, Joan Didion, a daughter of California, has been in a league all her own as a writer and novelist. Unlike most critics, she is capable of writing memorable fiction that, although not as widely read as her singular essays, stands the test of time. The Library of America series recently published the second volume of the novels Democracy and The Last Thing He Wanted, as well as nonfiction works like Salvador, Miami, and After Henry, her third essay collection. It was edited by David Ulin, the former LA Times book editor and author. Ulin spoke with us about the enduring legacy of Didion's work, highlighting her output in the 80s and 90s, which is not as well known. Ulin helps us unpack why Didion's later work matters and why her influence cannot be underestimated among younger generations of novelists and essayists. Here's my conversation with David Ulin discussing the life and work of Joan Didion. Joan Didion, what makes her work resound so much more than really anyone else of her generation, both the journalism repackaged as these books and also the novels?
Well, I think, you know, it's an interesting question, and I can only really answer it for myself and from my own perspective. But I think that, you know, first of all, I think she's highly skeptical. And she was highly skeptical, has been highly skeptical throughout. She was highly skeptical in the 1960s of both sides. You know, I mean, she started out as a conservative, a political conservative, as well as a social conservative. She, you know, one of my favorite sort of facts about her is that in 1962, when she was living in New York, she flew back to California to vote in the Republican gubernatorial primary because Richard Nixon, who ended up becoming, that's the famous, you won't have Dick Nixon to kick around anymore election. Anyway, Nixon, who was running for governor, you know, was in that primary, was insufficiently conservative for her. So she flew back to California to vote against Nixon because he was not sufficiently conservative. And yet, you know, within a couple of years, she's reporting on the counterculture and social and cultural changes in the country and in California, or California kind of as the fulcrum for many of those social and political changes in the country. And she's writing about them from a kind of position that is neither really right nor left. You know, she's looking askance at the policymakers. She's looking askance at the kind of failure or collapse of the so-called shared narrative. But at the same time, she's looking askance or looking critically at those who are trying to frame a different kind of narrative. So if you think about her essay, Slouching Towards Bethlehem, and the way that she portrays the Haight-Ashbury community in 1967 during the Summer of Love, she is writing and framing that that generation as a generation of lost children. On the one hand, you could read that as condescending, and it may have been in a certain sense. She was, you know, remember when she was in San Francisco, she was already in her early 30s. She was, you know, married. She had a kid. She was not by any means a hippie. But she is kind of empathetic, I think, to the sort of desire for a kind of bohemian romantic movement, even if she's not necessarily empathetic to the goals of that movement itself. And so I think that it positions her constantly, and she's constantly positioning herself in her work as a kind of outsider all the way around. And so I think that there's something that, for me at least, is resonant always, because it means that she's operating out of individual concern. She's looking at broad cultural and social movements, but always through the lens of her own subjectivity and acknowledging her own subjectivity. And I think that that is something that speaks very much, or I don't even want to just say to now, but speaks kind of ongoingly to a kind of way that we think about and engage with culture, which is often through our own lens first.
And I think you point out something really interesting there that I guess it didn't sort of align with, you know, her generation, but much like Hunter Thompson in a way, she was more of a child of the 50s than the 60s and was not a young kid at the time she's writing Slouching Towards Bethlehem and a lot of the early work that is, you know, that is rightfully adored now. And I guess I never really realized, you know, the conservative streak, but I guess being from the San Joaquin Valley and from Sacramento, if I have it right, you know, it maybe was much more conservative California there at that time.
Well, I think that's true. I mean, maybe even a child of the 40s, right? Didion, I mean, yes, certainly a child of the 50s, but, you know, Didion was born in 1934. So that means that she was, you know, 16 in 1950. And she was in Sacramento. She was, you know, in where I was from, the California memoir, the first memoir, but the California book that came out in 2003. She recalls, you know, being friendly in the late 40s in Sacramento with Earl Warren's daughter. Earl Warren at the time was the, before he went on to be Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, was governor of California. And, you know, being initiated into like a high school sorority in Warren's daughter's bedroom in the gubernatorial mansion. So again, I'm not necessarily saying that Didion was on that, you know, that the Didion family was at that level of kind of the power structure, but she had access to that. And also she was, you know, was aware of that kind of California, that kind of classic kind of California of the 1940s and early 1950s. The other thing that I think is a really important factor for her is that, you know, her ancestors came to California by the Oregon Trail. So they came before the railroads. They came to Sacramento. One side of her family, when they came from the Midwest, were briefly traveled with the Donner Party before the Donner Party tragedy happened. So she's got those kind of old California settler roots with her. I think that, you know, one of the, you know, so I think that there's an inherent kind of conservatism there too, in as much as if California has sort of old line society, right? Or if California as a, you know, as a U.S. state, I suppose, has old line society, it derives from, in part from those families that came that early. And so I think that that too, there's a kind of sense in her work of a kind of attachment to those California myths. The thing that's also really interesting about that work, and I'm thinking now particularly about early work like, you know, like Run River, some of the early essays, Notes of a Native Daughter that reflect on Sacramento when she was growing up. What's really interesting about that, though, is that she's always kind of rethinking. So one of the great moves of where I was from is that she basically undermines all of the mythologies upon which she was raised. You know, the myth of California individualism, the myth of the sort of, you know, the kind of, I don't know how to put it, like the purity, the so-called purity of agricultural California, when in fact it was built on the backs of black and brown workers. And she kind of takes that apart in where I was from. So the other thing about her too is that she's constantly reassessing, she's constantly self-interrogating, and she's constantly kind of arguing with herself and is willing to, I don't want to say to contradict herself, but to say I was wrong and now here's how I think about it. And so there's something interesting in that kind of both intellectual and I want to say perhaps even emotional flexibility that gives me this, I'm always aware of the writing as living. I'm aware of particularly in the essays, but also in the fiction, of her as the writer or the narrator thinking it through as she's writing, and the writing being a portrait as much of her rumination as it is a kind of narrative.
A lot of people who don't know you but know your work would not know that you are really from New York, but that you settled in California several decades ago and have just written about the state in many ways, and have edited collections of other books, which we're not discussing today. But as it relates to Didion, is this where you really took the deep dive and started to read a lot of this work when you were doing the collection writing Los Angeles? Or had you discovered Didion earlier in your life, in your New York days, say? And if so, you know, which book was it?
Well, to complicate the question, I discovered Didion in San Francisco, but... So the short version of the story is that I took a year off after high school, and with a friend, we drove from New York to San Francisco by way of Texas. We spent a couple of months in Texas roughnecking to make money, and then we ended up in San Francisco in February of 1980, and we rented an apartment on Haight Street. We were definitely, you know, post-hippie hippies or hippie wannabes, and we were delighted to be living in an apartment on Haight Street. And, you know, and while we were living there, I was trying to decide, I was just trying to decide about a lot of things. I was certainly going to go back east to college, but I was enough up in the air that my mother was worried about it. And so at a certain point while I was living on Haight Street in early 1980, she called me and said, I think you should read this book. And the book that she suggested was Slouching Towards Bethlehem, because she wanted me to read the Haight-Ashbury essay as a kind of cautionary tale. As it happened, I had already sort of developed my own living in the Haight, certainly. I had already developed my own kind of skepticism about certain aspects of the counterculture, particularly the burnout aspects of the counterculture, because one of the things that I was confronting daily on the streets in on Haight Street or, you know, Berkeley or other parts of the Bay Area were a lot of 60s casualties. And so I was already sort of thinking about kind of the flip side of that utopia, again, that utopian romantic movement and how people get lost. I wouldn't have articulated it that way at the age of 18, but it was definitely in my consciousness. And so when I read Slouching Towards Bethlehem, two things happened. I mean, when I read the essay, I recognized sort of the protean version of a lot of what I was seeing on the streets, and it made me kind of rethink my naive faith in counterculture, or, you know, again, utopian ecstaticism or ecstatic utopianism or whatever you want to call it. But the other thing that the whole book did was it turned me on to writing nonfiction. It blew my mind aesthetically. It had never occurred to me until I read this work that nonfiction could be literature. I mean, I'd certainly read some great essays. I'd read some Orwell in high school, things like that. But I hadn't really thought, I'd always thought that, you know, even the great essays I'd read were sort of ancillary work by novelists. It had never occurred to me that someone would, you know, that someone could devote themselves to essay writing. Then, of course, I discovered the whole tradition of essay writing and realized how much I didn't know. And that was really exciting. But Didion was the catalyst in that way. And so I read Slouching and then immediately went out and bought the White Album and read that. I read them back to back. I often think about those two books as one long book, probably because of that experience. And then I went back to the East Coast. I went to college. I kept reading Didion books as they came out and kind of lamenting in a certain sense the fact that there was no subsequent essay collection. There wasn't an essay collection until after Henry came out in 1992, another essay collection. But I read Salvador when it came out. I read Miami when it came out. I went back and looked at some of the novels. But there was something so profoundly transformative for me about the idea of nonfiction writing. The idea that I could write narrative or work in narrative that was also rooted in current events and could build it around the experience of what it was like to live in the time I was living was profoundly thrilling. And so that was a huge turning point for me. The other thing that was really fascinating about it, though, was that it made me think about California in a different way. Even though I left and went back to the East Coast for 10 years after my sojourn in San Francisco, I always had it in the back of my mind to go back, or to come back, I should say. And so I was, you know, and so I was looking for clues. I always look for clues in reading. I always look for clues in books. And when I decided to move to Los Angeles, which was really probably around 1990, I moved here in 1991, I went on a concerted reading, Los Angeles reading binge, just to sort of see what was there. I discovered this wealth of literature that I, as a kind of parochial East Coaster, didn't necessarily know existed. But I also went back and started really looking at things like Play It As It Lays, for instance, or, reading the essays again and thinking about California as a dynamic, multidimensional universe. And so Didion was very much a huge part of that. The other thing, though, that I want to say as well is that it was also the sentences that attracted me. I mean, the sentences are magnificent. And as I was thinking more and more consciously about writing and what kind of writer I wanted to be and what it meant to be a writer and what kinds of what I was drawn to and what kinds of skills I wanted to work on, I became increasingly infatuated with with the sentence. And I do think I'm still a kind of sentence to sentence writer. I want the sentences. I want the sentences to be a certain way, and I almost think the meaning comes out of the sentences rather than the other way around. And Didion was, there are others as well, but Didion was one of the main early influences for me in that regard.
Now, the second collection for the Library of America is, I guess what you'd say is maybe the lesser known, because this, the 60s, 70s stuff, which we've been sort of discussing, is a lot, is the entry point for many people. But I also think that this new collection, which encapsulates the books Salvador, Democracy, Miami, After Henry, which, if I remember correctly, was her editor who passed away, the Henry.
Yeah, Henry Robbins died of a heart attack on the platform, on the Union Square 456 platform in the summer of 1979.
Oh man, that's a horrible ending.
Yeah.
And then the last thing he wanted, which I've not read, and I think maybe Hilton Ells has been a big champion as we, kind of pivot to the fiction stuff we touched on earlier, of championing sort of the novels, even though he himself is sort of known as this, essayist in a very distinct voice like hers. But he's been a big champion of the novels too. What's remarkable about Didion, just on its face, and I remember Christopher Hitchens, he always envied people who could do, who were capable of fiction and nonfiction. And I think it was something he struggled with, not being able to write novels, but being able to do this, really prolific amount of nonfiction work pouring out of him. And Didion is one of those rare writers that was capable of both and really kind of has a different body of work that you could read similarly. But like you said earlier, we're all sort of drawn to the wonder of the nonfiction that sometimes it shortchanges some of the novels.
I think that's right. And I, as I was saying earlier, I always sort of second or short shrifted the fiction, I would say. Again, partly because the nonfiction was so exceptional. And it is a convenient trope to say, she's a brilliant essayist and maybe not such a great novelist. And actually, to be honest, finishing that, there were, when I signed on to do the Didion project, there were two Didion books I had not read at that point. One was The Last Thing He Wanted, and the other was Democracy, which is also a novel. So that was two novels. So I'd read anything else. But so discovering those last two, or finally encountering those last two novels, which I'd certainly had on my shelf but hadn't read, and also thinking about the way that the books move and are in conversation with each other kind of thematically and chronologically, made me realize how integral the fiction is to the entire project. So, if you want to look at sort of shape of the career, she begins with a novel, which is Run River, which I actually think is a spectacularly underrated first novel. Basically looking back to that Sacramento River agricultural world of the 40s and 50s, a world that at the end of the novel is about to be basically imploded in some sense by real estate development. I think it's really interesting that in this novel, which ends in 1959 and was published in 1963, the antagonist is a real estate developer. He's not only an antagonist because he's the real estate developer, but that's important. And there's something interesting about the way that Didion is moving not only in that novel, but throughout a lot of the essays in Slouching, some of the essays in the White Album, other places, to, in this vision of California as being somehow changed, if not corrupted, by rampant real estate development. Now, in part, that's a class issue, right? If you look at an essay like Some Dreamers of the Golden Dream, where she's critiquing Lucille Miller and Gordon Miller, the murder in San Bernardino, she's certainly making pointed class judgments about the Millers and others who either came to California or trying to work their way up through the middle class. And so I think we can't avoid looking at that in some way. But she kind of sets up this sort of mythic California in that book that then she goes on to kind of pull apart in Slouching. Then, she moves from there to Los Angeles, to Southern California. She's working in Hollywood. It makes sense then that the second novel, Play It As It Lays, which comes out after Slouching, is a Hollywood novel, but also a novel about despair and disruption and an alienated an alienated female protagonist, which is often Didion's own persona in her own work in terms of both her life and the stuff that she's moving through. And then this interesting shift happens in the late 70s, which we tend to forget about because the White Album came out in 1979 and it is so much mostly a California book. But there's this interesting move in the 70s where she gets fascinated by globalism, particularly in terms of Latin America. And so we have Book of Common Prayer, which comes out in 1977, which is a novel that takes place in an invented Latin American country. And that novel is kind of generated or triggered in some way by her essay on Bogota, which is collected in the White Album. And then we move into the 80s and 90s, which are the books that are in this current volume. And they continue to grow out of that. So we have Salvador, which is her account of a 2 or 3 week reporting trip she took to El Salvador during the Civil War in the early 1980s. That leads her to Democracy, which I actually think is her best novel, which is a novel narrated by a writer named Joan Didion, writing supposedly about people she knows. So it's blurring the line, or people she's met or encountered. So it's blurring the genre line. It's a really interesting kind of, you know, metafiction or autofiction, even sort of from 1984. And then from there into Miami, which is really about Cuban community in Miami, the Cuban diaspora, which also starts to bring in, as does Democracy, you know, conspiracy theory, CIA, black ops, all of that kind of thing, Kennedy assassination, all of those issues. And from there, this kind of continue, this sort of political vein, this vein of political writing continues until about 2000 when she publishes Political Fictions, which are all the campaign essays. There's a lot of political writing in After Henry, a lot of coverage of the Reagan presidency, a lot of coverage of Los Angeles city politics. So what's interesting is that we can kind of see through the conflation of the fiction and the nonfiction, or the way that they're in conversation with each other, a real expansion of her vision, let's say, or her sensibility, moving from the personal to the political and to the global, although always through that filter of the personal. And so I think that, you know, it's much more useful for us to think about her fiction as part of a larger body of work rather than to think, you know, think dualistically about, oh, well, here's the nonfiction work and here's the fiction work.
And I think the other thing, you touched on a lot of these essays in the new collection. I think maybe I'm, what's the right word? I romanticize this idea that there was a time, probably before both of our generations, where, you know, a lot of the stuff Didion was doing was like appearing in form in a magazine first, or the New York Review of Books, or, you know, where she was able to go really long on a particular subject. And then this stuff often became the fodder of the next book, by being able to write and take the time to do this. And the works, you know, kind of reflect that, I think. I don't know, maybe I'm reading into it too much, but in a way, the development of her as a writer was in part helped by the mid-century, 20th century magazines that she was, where some of these pieces were appearing, to begin with.
Without question. I think that's exactly right.
And so then when they're recollected in these books, it's almost like there isn't a path today for a writer to have the kind of impact that Didion have, or Tom Wolfe would maybe be another example, where, you know, most of those early essay books were all like pieces in Esquire or the Herald Tribune that were sort of adapted, you know, Candy Color Cornflake, Streamline Baby, and, you know, Electric Kool-Aid Acid Test and the
yeah,
like.
Yeah, or even just fully collected. I mean, Didion, is without question this is true. I mean, Didion got her, you know, honed her chops out of school at women's magazines in New York, including Vogue, where she was taught I can't remember the editor's name now. I think Tally was her last name, but she was basically started out writing captions. And the captions were very, very concise, obviously, and very, very space specific. So she was writing short and pithy to length for publication. I know that sounds like industrial or mechanical writing, but as someone who has done a bunch of that writing myself, I think it's the greatest possible training you can have as a writer, because it teaches you to cut out all the bullshit, and you have to get the point across in the available space. You can't say, oh, I need more space. That's one of the reasons those sentences are so beautiful. She moved on from there to writing for a variety of, you know, of major national magazines, right? The, you know, the, again, the Haight-Ashbury essay we were talking about, which is a 40-page essay in the book. So we're talking 15 to 20,000 words, something along those lines, was published in its entirety at length in the Saturday Evening Post. Some Dreamers of the Golden Dream, the Lucille Miller piece, was essentially a true crime story. It was essentially a trial report. It was a piece of reportage about a murder trial. The genius of Didion in 1967 was that she doesn't mention the murder for 4 or 5 pages while she's setting the scene of San Bernardino and California and the Santa Anas and all this kind of stuff. And the genius of the Saturday Evening Post in 1967 was that they didn't say to her, you got to cut these 4 pages and start with the murder because our readers won't stick with you. So I do think that there's something really interesting about the kind of opportunity that was presented to writers like, and Didion's not the only one, you're right. Wolf is another example. You can think about Norman Mailer writing Miami and the Siege of Chicago as 2 long pieces for Harper's and then gathering them, gathering them for, into that book. And, you know, yeah, I think, so there was a different kind of infrastructure. And so real work came out there. I mean, Ellen Willis, the late rock critic, or more than that, rock and political and social critic for the Village Voice, among others, was another example. I mean, she wrote this phenomenal piece that was published in Rolling Stone in 1976 or 77 called Next Year in Jerusalem, which is essentially about being deputized by her family to go to Israel and try and get her younger brother out of what they felt were the grasp of a conservative fundamentalist rabbi. Willis turns that into a remarkable essay about faith and its discontents and her own sort of questions about faith, because she's kind, she's sympathetic. Ultimately, her feminism, among other things, won't allow her to go there. But it, you know, that piece is 25,000 words, I want to say, and it was published as a long feature in Rolling Stone before it became the centerpiece of her first, or one of the centerpieces of her first collection, beginning to see the light. So I think there were a lot of those kind of opportunities and a lot of ways to explore material in shorter form or periodical form or, you know, whatever, and then develop it into a book or collect it into a book, that, yes, it's true, with the kind of collapse of traditional media, we don't have the same kinds of access or formats. I mean, you can certainly still publish periodical pieces and collect them, and many people do, and you can certainly publish shorter versions and develop them into, you know, short, a longer, like a cover story or something, and develop it into a book. I've done that with a couple of my own books, but it's very difficult and much rarer to have the kind of audience that you would have had in a magazine like, say, the Saturday Evening Post or Life, where Didion and her husband John Gregory Dunn shared a column, Points West, for a number of years.
It's remarkable how, you know, they would just run really, really long stuff. And it made sense at the time with the print magazines and the advertising and the way that it worked then. And then I this is just something that affected me, but maybe you've had a similar experience because I know you read so widely. But Didion, to me, I can't even remember what pieces these were or what books they're in, but she's kind of like, she somehow writes about things where she ends up being, for me anyways, has been a good book recommender. Where, you know, she's writing about something and then I'll read Victory by Joseph Conrad because she's talking about, you know, how Conrad's using this different narrative technique. Or she talks about The Octopus by Frank Norris, which is sort of about industrial California, the time you're talking about her settler kind of roots. But I found Didion to be, you know, kind of an unofficial book recommender in that I can't even remember what pieces I was reading where she talked about these novels, but there's a number of books that I read because she wrote about them. And I'm curious if you had that sort of same experience with her.
For me, it's more the kind of the more glancing work, like the verse, you know, the line of verse or the stanza from a poem that she'll put in either as an epigraph or quote at the end of a piece. And that I'll, you know, that I will then look up that, you know, I'll look up that verse and find the poem, and it may be a poem that I should have known or knew and didn't remember, or maybe a poem, that I didn't know. I mean, I always kind of have a recognition when she talks about someone like Norris, like Frank Norris and the octopus, but I'm always interested to see how she weaves it together. For me, it's more of the kind of the incidental text that she brings up. The other stuff that I find really interesting that she raises that are the kind of historical texts, the histories, particularly in terms of California, the historical data and the demographic data. When I, again, go back to the real estate developer thing, when I was doing the chronology and notes for these books, particularly for the first book, I was really struck as I was looking through and doing textual notes and kind of tracking down, all of these references that she made in the essays and even in fiction, how much had to do with development, commercial real estate, business plans, things like that. And so that is not a territory, obviously, that I read widely in. So her kind of acuity in that sort of what I guess we would call industrial writing, right, or industrial literature, is really interesting. I mean, I sort of expect her to be well-read and erudite about film and books. But when we get into sort of the literature of business and the history of business, that's an area that I think, you know, she kind of encodes that stuff into her language and into her sentences. So it just seems like data that's kind of coming off of her fingertips in a certain sense, but there is definitely there's a deep knowledge of that sort of material. And that, again, that maybe on this read through, because that's my most recent reading of her work, has to do with the reading I've been doing for this project. That's been the work that has kind of jumped out at me the most.
There's several new Didion books out besides Steffi Nelson's in your Library of America second collection. There's also this new short book of essays from Didion from the archives.
Yes, there's let me tell you what I mean. It's 12 short essays that were never before collected. They range from 1968 to 2000. A couple of them I'd read before, but many of them I hadn't. Half of them, I believe, or maybe a little over half of them, are from that Points West column I was referring to earlier that she shared with Dunn. They would kind of alternate who wrote them, so they're her pieces, including a famous piece about Nancy Reagan. Then the book is filled in with five other later and longer essays. I think, you know, there's really interesting writing in the book, and I'm always eager to read anything that she's written. I don't think, how would I put it? I don't know that the column format, the Points West column format, was the best format for her as a writer, because it's short. I mean, short relatively. We're talking about the time, so 2,000 words now would be 800 words. But 2,000 words, and I think that, you know, and some of them, the Nancy Reagan one as an example, are quite interesting. But I think that it doesn't give her enough space. You know, I mean, as she sort of says, or I think Hilton Hall says in his introduction to that collection, that, the point of a column is you go in with a point that you're illustrating, and, you know, and the column is a kind of a directed piece of writing. And I think that that's a really good description. But I don't think it necessarily suits Didion's talents as much as the kind of longer flowing sort of, essay that we think of her for. I think she's a much more effective writer when she's asking questions rather than trying to make an argument or make a point. And I think she really needs room to stretch. So it's really the second part of the second part of the book with the longer pieces, and particularly an essay called Why I Write, which is an homage to Orwell, since he wrote an essay of the same name in the late 40s, that she published in the New York Times Book Review in 1976. It's one of my favorite essays of hers. And she talks about the ruthlessness of the necessary ruthlessness of being a writer, echoing in some way that famous opening to the book Slouching, where she talks about writers are always selling somebody out. But she's self-interrogating about the question of Writers and control. She writes about how writing can be and often is an aggressive act where you're, you know, kind of imposing your sensibility on the reader. I don't think that's always the case, but I think it can be the case. And I think it's rare for a writer to kind of cop to that in a certain sense. And then there's a really terrific essay in that collection too that was originally written as the introduction to a very strange little curio, which is called Telling Stories, which was published by Bancroft Library at University of California, Berkeley in the mid-70s, along with three short stories that she had published in the 1960s as a kind of Friends of the Library thing. They're the only three short stories in that collection are the only three short stories she has ever published. They've never been collected anywhere else. And this is an essay where she talks about the process of writing stories, why she doesn't think she's a particularly good short story writer, and also kind of talks a little bit about her education as a writer at Berkeley and as a student in a writing workshop. Again, those two essays alone are worth the price of admission, because I think Didion reflecting on herself as a writer is really interesting and really acute. I like when she turns the lens on herself. I like particularly when she turns the lens on herself where there's a subject that she's dealing with. It's not just necessarily herself, but her in a certain terrain. And I think that there is something really fascinating about the way that she sort of treats herself as a subject with that same kind of clinical skepticism that she treats the other people she writes about.
The Library of America's Joan Didion 1980s and 1990s collection, edited by David Ulin, is out now in hardcover. For the reading this episode, journalist and author Steffi Nelson reads the piece A Trip to Xanadu from the recently published collection of Odds and Ends by Didion, entitled Let Me Tell You What I Mean, published by Knopft. Nelson, it should be noted, is the author of Slouching Towards Los Angeles, a collection of essays about Didion and Los Angeles, published by Rare Bird Books.
It has been for almost half a century a peculiar and affecting image in the California mind. San Simeon, La Cuesta Encantada, the phantasmagoric barony that William Randolph Hearst made for himself on the sunburned hills above the San Luis Obispo County coast. California children used to hear about San Simeon when they were very small. I know, because I was one of them. Used to be told to watch for it from Highway 1, quite far in the distance, crested on the hill, the great Moorish towers and battlements shimmering in the sun or floating fantastically just above the coastal fog. San Simeon was a place which, once seen from the highway, was ever in the mind, a material fact which existed in proof of certain abstract principles. San Simeon seemed to confirm the boundless promise of the place we lived. The gates were always barred on that road up the hill, and yet there was a kind of frontier accessibility about the Hearsts. The Hearst money was Western money, money that had come originally from a silver strike in Nevada, money made and spent in a singularly Western spirit of luck, imagination, irresponsibility, and general flamboyance. If a Hearst could build himself a castle, then every man could be a king. San Simeon was, moreover, exactly the castle a child would build if a child had $220 million and could spend $40 million of it on a castle. A sand castle, an implausibility, a place swimming in warm golden light and theatrical mists, a pleasure dome decreed by a man who insisted, out of the one dark fear we all know about, that all the surfaces be gay and brilliant and playful. More than any other place ever built in this country, San Simeon was dedicated to the proposition that all the pleasures of infinity are to be found in the here and now. The leaves never fell at San Simeon. Nothing went bare or died. All year long, the roses and fuchsia and the bougainvillea blossomed. 500,000 gallons of water glittered in the great pools. Zebras and eland roamed the golden hills. The carry-on bells could be heard for 30 miles. Brilliant Sienese flags fluttered over the long refectory dining tables. The guests ate pressed duck and wiped their hands on paper napkins. Again, a child's fantasy, every meal a picnic. The spirit of San Simeon was uninhibited by nervous adult distinctions about what was correct and what was not, what was good and what was less good, what was art and what not. If William Randolph Hearst liked something, he bought it and brought it to San Simeon. And a child would people his castle with exactly the same cast. There was the omnipotent king, the spurned queen, the captive princess from another land. There were the ambitious underlings bearing dispatches from the capitals of the earth. And of course, there were the courtiers, the decorative courtiers, some of whom came for the weekend and stayed for months because no one was banished from this court unless he drank too much or mentioned death. There were to be no shadows at all in this fairy tale. San Simeon was to be the kingdom where nobody dies.
To support Big Table, go to bigtablepodcast.org/bookshop. You can help us and independent bookstore culture at the same time. Big Table is produced and presented by Hat and Beard Press, Dub Lab, and Gold Diggers in Los Angeles, and is supported by Invisible Republic, a nonprofit arts organization based in Chicago, New York, and Los Angeles. You can learn more about their community-based programs and publications at invisiblerepublic.org. Big Table would not exist in the audio world without the expert skill sets, friendship, and dedication of sound designer and editor Matea Baim and audio engineer Jacob Ross. Special thanks to Eric Gorman at Gold Diggers and Alejandro Ali Cohen at Dub Lab for early encouragement and engineering prowess. Thanks again for listening.